Changi Airport tells the Straits Times there are no reopening plans for Terminal 2 unless air travel picks up. Fort Siloso on Sentosa is to be gazetted as a national monument, bringing Singapore's list of monuments to 73. And in today's Invest segment, we have tips on how to save thousands of dollars on your home renovation. You're watching The Big Story. I'm Olivia Kuei. You can subscribe to The Straits Times channel so you never miss a single episode. The Straits Times has learned that Changi Airport Terminal 2 will not be reopening anytime soon. Operations there were suspended in May 2020, with airlines relocated to the other terminals. T2 had been scheduled to resume operations in November last year, but renovation works are still ongoing, with reopening plans now postponed indefinitely. Changi Airport Group telling ST that the terminal will only reopen in phases as air traffic recovers. As transport correspondent To Ting Wei explains, this indefinite closure was not unexpected.
So this is not really a major setback per se, like a new setback, in the sense that it's kind of more of an illustration to show how the pandemic has been dragging on for much longer than what we all thought it would do initially. So the projection that T2 will close for 18 months was made back in May 2020. So that was during the circuit breaker. And then at that point in time, I guess we all knew that COVID was bad, but we would have thought like 2 years later, it will probably be much better already. So what it reflects now is not that like, oh, the recovery has suddenly stopped or something like that. It doesn't, but it reflects like the pace of recovery has been so slow that it turns out like we might actually need maybe 3 years or 4 years to get things back to normal, like as it was before the COVID pandemic. So for that case, like because for T2, the upgrading will bring it to around a handling capacity of 28 million passengers. But currently with T1 and T3 by itself, the two remaining terminals which are open, they can already handle 46 million passengers yearly. And that is far more than what Changi Airport requires at the moment based on the number of passengers passing through Changi Airport. So yeah, in the sense, it's still a sign that aviation recovery is lagging, but it's not really a new setback per se. So as to when it will open, so as mentioned, T1 and T3 can handle about 46 million passengers annually now. So when you look at whether there's a need for T2 to reopen so soon, especially when there's still T4 that's on standby, I don't think we'll see it open this year. Probably not this year, maybe sometime next year. And that's only the case if Singapore and other countries in the region open up substantially. So we are looking at more VTLs, more like, maybe not even VTLs, like you might need to open up generally to like more travelers with less conditions as opposed to what the VTLs have. So yeah, as to when exactly, we can't really pinpoint the moment. It's very unpredictable. So I mean, we can only wait for updates from Changi on that.
In other local news, Fort Siloso on Sentosa has been proposed to be gazetted as a national monument, the highest form of recognition for a structure or site's significance. It also accords them legal protection from alterations and changes that would affect their character and significance. Fort Siloso is the best preserved 19th century fort in Singapore and serves as an important site to mark the war years here. Now a military museum, it contains World War II memorabilia, including coastal guns and the remains of fortified military structures and tunnels. Following reports on the spate of SMS phishing scams, the Monetary Authority of Singapore says OCBC Bank will be conducting a thorough probe to identify the deficiencies in its processes and implement the necessary measures. And subsequently, MAS will consider the appropriate supervisory actions. Well, a quick recap of what we know so far. A police statement on December the 30th last year revealed that nearly 470 OCBC bank customers had lost at least $8.5 million to scammers sending unsolicited SMSs to victims, claiming there were issues with their banking accounts. The message directed these customers to click on a link to resolve the issue, and this led to fake bank websites where victims keyed in their internet banking account login details. Victims said they were fooled because the fake SMSs had appeared in the same message thread as genuine ones that OCBC previously sent for one-time passwords or transaction alerts. While lawyers said the extent of liabilities either to the bank or customers depends on the circumstance of the scam, OCBC said it's already been making goodwill payments to affected customers. It's been doing so since January the 8th, and more than 30 customers so far have received the payments. But the bank did not say how much it's paid out or if it intends to fully compensate every victim. With more is Brian Tan, who heads the Technology, Media and Telecommunications Practice at law firm Pinsent Masons. Brian, do the affected OCBC customers have legal recourse to completely recover their lost funds?
Well, the question of legal recourse is quite a difficult one to determine. Banks have basically two obligations that they owe to customers. One is a contractual obligation, where they are to deal with the customer's money according to the contract they have with the customers. And the second is a duty of care or duty in negligence, not to be negligent in how they deal with that. On both scores, if the customer has been acting in accordance with the agreed procedure that the bank has put in place, then the bank is entitled to deal with the funds as provided for, as ordered. And in the bank's view, it would have followed those procedures. The second would be whether the bank was negligent. Again, this is a matter that you need to establish that the bank didn't follow its processes, or it could have, it had a standard of care that it didn't observe. Then there would be legal recourse. But on the whole, I'll say that customers or banks will have an uphill battle in trying to find legal recourse against a bank.
Well, Brian, you talked about negligence on the part of the bank, or possible negligence on the part of the bank. Building on that, under which circumstances would OCBC or any bank in a similar situation be liable?
So, for instance, if the bank has not followed an agreed or an industry standard of practice, then the bank could possibly face claims where losses have accrued from that. If, for instance, the bank has also acted after it has received contrary information, so where a notice of losses or notice of fraudulent activity had taken place and the bank did nothing, then liability would also accrue. Again, these are very hard to prove, as in this case, and this would be, again, an uphill battle for bank customers to prove.
Well, it is important to note that OCBC's banking systems were not compromised when the December scams were carried out. Brian, to prevent future phishing attempts, do systems outside the banks need monitoring? And what is an appropriate level of surveillance? Because, you know, privacy laws will have to be considered as well.
Yes. So we can see that from here, what we call the perimeter defenses of the banks have remained intact. Right, there hasn't been an attack on those perimeter defenses. There wasn't a hacking through the bank systems. But what we have here is one activity that's done outside of the bank systems, which then impact how the bank systems have been accessed. And possibly after that activity within the bank, where you see all these transactions taking place, and whether the fraud systems pick that up. So I think two of the things that could be focused on would be these two areas. One, activity that's outside of the bank. How much surveillance should be done? Now, this is a tricky question to try to navigate, because you do too much of it, people will say that it's an invasion of privacy. But if you do too little of it, then there's a lot of incorrect behavior, incorrect activity that runs outside of the bank that has gone unnoticed. And secondly, I think the banks should do, and they should also continue to do, to monitor the transaction levels that occur within the banking system to see whether there are any trends that are unusual that they hopefully can then pick up and take appropriate action.
Well, thanks so much, Brian. Lawyer Brian Tan, a partner at Pinsent Masons. A quick look at news overseas. Hong Kong police have arrested and charged two former Cathay Pacific flight attendants for allegedly breaching their quarantine period, which led to the city's Omicron outbreak and a further tightening of already strict COVID-19 rules. The pair face up to 6 months in prison and a $640 fine. They've been released on bail and their cases will be heard next month. Australia today suffering its deadliest day from COVID-19 with a total of 77 deaths recorded. The country is dealing with its worst COVID-19 outbreak, putting more strain on hospitals and intensive care than and at any time during the pandemic. But the government has ruled out lockdowns due to high vaccination levels. How can you save thousands of dollars on your home renovation? Well, it's a bit too late for me, but let's find out more about these tips in this week's Invest segment with Haryanto Diman.
Renovating a home always sounds exciting, but it can also be stressful and sometimes even a bit of a nightmare. Now, how do you turn a rundown flat into the home of your dreams? There's so much to consider when planning a home renovation that it can be hard to know how to budget for it. Following a few rules will help, and we've got just the right person to help us figure it all out. I'm pleased to welcome Invest editor Tan Wee Boon on the show. Hey, Wee Boon. Wee Boon, tell us about this special series that you've been working on. I understand it stems from your own experience of renovating your place.
Well, I realized very early in life that when it comes to money, it pays to do some planning. And in the case of renovation, really do your homework. Here's a big incentive on why you should do the homework. You can potentially save up to 30% of your initial budget. This means that if you allocate, say, $100,000 for your home improvement, planning means that you can save up to $30,000, which you can then use to buy your new aircon and furniture. So this is what the SD Renovation Series seeks to do. We hope to give you some tips on the financial planning of your home renovation so that you can spend wisely. More importantly, don't overspend if you have plans to sell your property a few years down the road. We are also sharing tips on how you can shop smart. This is because you also need to spend quite a bit on new household appliances and other fittings for your newly renovated home. All this can add up, and so it helps to take a step back and do some calculation.
Now, Wee-Boon, for someone who's looking to renovate their home, where do they even start? And how do they make the most out of their investment?
Well, the proper way to put yourself in the game is actually to get a good sense on how renovation people price their services. After all, unless you have been renovating your home regularly, you wouldn't know how much to pay. So if you don't know who to call, the starting point is actually the HDB directory of renovation contractors. This applies even if you're living in a condo or a house. All contractors there are actually licensed by the HDB, and they have the basic know-how of what some of the rules are. So they won't go down and knock down some walls illegally and without permit. More importantly, to join the list, the contractors there have to show that they have a genuine business here. Of course, this may not guarantee good service all the time, but at least you know that they have a proper place of business and they won't disappear overnight. Once you have done your first selection, ask at least two of these contractors to come to take a look at your home. Tell them what you need. Ask them to give you an estimated cost for your renovation. This is like a company tender exercise. It is very useful because you can only spend wisely if you know what they're paying for. Ask for all kinds of costs, the basic renovation, as well as for the cost of fixing electrical wiring and lights. When you get the quotes, you can then compare which contractor's cost is actually more reasonable. In my own experience, this is where you can save the most. For example, some contractor will charge $50 to fix a PowerPoint, and another will actually charge double to the same thing. If they can mark up the prices for about 100% for such items, I'm sure you will wonder what else is being charged double. So therefore, you need to be very detailed because it is your money at stake here. Finally, if you're not happy even with the first two that you have selected, call a third or even a fourth one. Yes, it's a lot of work, but I can tell you that it is rewarding when you finally find the best partner to work with for your renovation.
Great tips right there, Wibun. That was our Invest editor, Tan Wibun. We have plenty more to discuss, but we're going to have to leave that for next week. Do join us for more tips on how you can save thousands of dollars on your home renovation. You can follow Wibun's series at str.sg/invest.
Well, thanks so much, Arianto. Visit StraitsTimes.com for more news and our YouTube channel for more videos. Subscribe by hitting the red button below. I'm Olivia Quay. See you tomorrow on The Big Story.